Greetings, fellow nerds. I've been continuing to research the production of sodium metal this past month using the alcohol catalyzed magnesium reduction approach. Very briefly, I've attacked and conquered many problems, including trying to find a workable solvent, reaction times, processing methods and dioxane, preventing glassware destruction, trying to dry the reagents using easy to obtain drying agents like aluminum and lithium metal, putting together our research into a mechanism, and finally finding some very easy to obtain off-the-shelf catalysts like menthol, tetrahydrolenol oil, dimethyl, and boreal. Now menthol is a great catalyst, being cheap and easy to obtain for most amateurs. But boreal is a faster catalyst and would be preferred if it were easy to get. Unfortunately, it's not as readily available as menthol, so a way of making boreal from more readily available camphor would be preferable. So I've been looking at various ways to synthesize boreal. First, I want to test if camphor itself would work as a catalyst. Now I know it seems unusual since camphor is a ketone and our theory says absolutely nothing about ketones working. But I wanted to try it not as a direct catalyst, but as a pre-catalyst. In my research on making boreal, I found a few papers that reduced camphor to boreal by reaction with sodium metal. Since we're adding sodium anyway as the reducing agent, I thought adding camphor might be viable as the idea would be to make boreal in situ. Camphor would be a pre-catalyst rather than a direct catalyst. So I set up a half-scale reaction with camphor as the catalyst and it failed. The magnesium looks the same so it's not being consumed. The color change is likely the camphor undergoing aldol condensation reactions. So it's not creating boreal, it's just getting destroyed. So it looks like camphor can't be used as a pre-catalyst. Not to let an experiment go to waste, I directly added a gram of boreal and attempted to make sodium. The reason why I'm testing a mixture now is because I want to know if boreal contaminated with camphor would still work. This is to know that if I make boreal from camphor and don't get a pure product, would the sodium production reaction still work? If this works, then I just need to make crude boreal and that would simplify the process. If this doesn't work, then I need to rigorously purify any boreal I make and design my synthetic procedure accordingly. And it looks like it's working. Hydrogen production is proceeding normally, and the decomposition of magnesium, along with direct observation of more liquid sodium than what I started with, means we're making sodium. So camphor might reduce the yield by reacting with sodium, but it doesn't seem to inhibit the sodium production reaction. I'll keep this in mind when trying to make boreal from camphor. Moving on, I want to test isoboreal as a catalyst. It's actually an isomer of boreal. Now it's more expensive than regular boreal and even harder to find, so it's not worth as a catalyst. But it is a product of some methods of reducing camphor, so I want to know if it had different catalytic properties. If it's dramatically different, then that would mean two important things. One, I need to select for one of them when reducing camphor, and two, it might actually provide insight into the mechanism of the reaction. According to our current mechanism, such a small change should theoretically have no noticeable effect. But who knows, this would be very interesting if I was proven wrong. Now after running the experiment, it appears to work. It took about 12 hours to stop this time rather than boreal's 10 hours, but I'm going to attribute that to process variation. Yield seems to be in the same range as well. Isoboreal doesn't seem to be much different than boreal. So this means we don't have to pay too close attention to our product distribution when making boreal. Moving on, I was finally able to acquire some cyclohexanol. If you recall my lab notes video back in November, I was testing lots of catalysts and constructed a mechanism that explained most of the features and allowed us to determine that sterically hindered or sterically rigid secondary alcohols would work as catalysts. This led us to the discovery of menthol and boreal as being viable high-yielding catalysts. But we didn't really know if structural rigidity or steric hindrance was the key feature needed. Cyclohexanol is hard to get but would be the perfect model catalyst because it's structurally rigid, but not much more structurally hindered than other secondary alcohols. If this worked, it would prove that structural rigidity was the key feature. If it failed, it would prove that steric hindrance was the key feature. So I ran the sodium production reaction with cyclohexanol. And it failed actually. There was some hydrogen production at first, but it backflowed just a couple of hours in. The magnesium is still intact, so it wasn't consumed very much. If extra sodium was produced, I wasn't able to cleanly separate it from all leftover magnesium. Cyclohexanol is behaving more like norlimbinol and cohenol rather than menthol, but it's structurally rigid just like menthol. This is the key insight we've been looking for. We now know that steric bulk and not structural rigidity is the key feature needed for a working catalyst. This should greatly help our search for other catalysts. One intriguing possibility is that this result says primary alcohols might be viable. Previously, absolutely every experiment among myself and the amateur community unequivocally showed that primary alcohols failed every time. Maybe we need something super bulky. I'll keep searching in that direction. Academically, this result is an important find in that it greatly narrows down the mechanisms for catalyst loss. We're many steps closer to publishing this project, but we still haven't figured out exactly how steric bulk prevents catalyst loss. Two possibilities is that steric bulk prevents physical loss into the product, or that it prevents a transition state alignment that decomposes the catalyst. In looking at the results again, I think it might be the latter. See how the cyclohexanol test is changing color as it fails? This might be the cyclohexanol is decomposing, but it could also simply be impurities in the cyclohexanol decomposing. I'll still need to run more testing to be sure. Alright, moving on. I'm still trying to find ways to separate magnesium from sodium in an attempt to avoid using dioxane. The most promising avenue I've found so far is to heat the sodium until it melts with mineral oil with a small amount of menthol. Then, if I physically stir it, the magnesium occasionally separates from the sodium and falls to the bottom as a powder. Now I say occasionally because this method doesn't seem very reliable. Sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. I've been trying to find the exact conditions, but so far I think it has something to do with the air. Fresh samples of sodium right from the production reaction do not separate, but older samples that have been sitting in oil for a few days tend to work better. I think what happens is the air is diffusing into the mineral oil a bit and oxidizing the surface of the sodium. It's minor, but it's happening. Then when I melt the sodium and stir it, the sodium oxide coats the magnesium particles and separates out. Now I know it sounds obvious, just keep waiting and doing it again until it works. But even then, reliability hasn't been great and it really sucks to have to spend a week just to make 10 grams of sodium. Just as bad is that sometimes it fails even worse and produces these drops of sodium that don't coalesce. So I need to figure out how to up the reliability, quality, and make it work faster. So that's what I've been up to this month. I think I'm going to start on the final video. I was complaining in November of having too many new discoveries, now we have very little. I think this is a good time to condense everything we have learned into something we can fit into a single video. Hopefully I'll get that video ready soon. Thanks for watching.